शुद्धोऽसि बुद्धोऽसि निरञ्जनोऽसि संसारमाया परिवर्जितोऽसि संसारस्वप्नं त्यज्य मोहनिद्रां मदालसोल्लापनुवाच पुत्रम् शुद्धोऽसि रेता तनतेऽसि नाम कृतं हि ते कल्पनयाधुनैव पञ्चात्मकं देहमिदं न तेऽस्ति नैवास्य त्वं रोदिषि कस्य हेतु न वा भवान् रोदिति विश्वजन्मा शब्दोऽयमायाद्य महीषसूनु विकल्प्यमाना विविधैर्गुणैस्ते गुणाश्च भवता सकलेन्द्रियेषु भूतानि भूतैः परिदुर्बलानि वृद्धिं समायान्ति यथेह पुंसः अन्नाम्बुपानादिभिरेव तस्मात् न तेऽसि वृद्धिर्न च तेऽस्ति हानि त्वं कञ्चुकेशीर्यमाणे निजोऽस्मिन् तस्मिन् देहे मूढतां मा व्रजेथ शुभाशुभाय कर्मभिर्देहमेतन् मदादिभिः कञ्चुकस्तेऽपि नद्ध तातेति किञ्चित् तनयेति किञ्चित् अम्बेति किञ्चित् धैतेति किञ्चित् ममेति किञ्चिन्न ममेति किञ्चित् त्वं भूतसङ्घं बहुमालपेता शुद्धोऽसि बुद्धोऽसि निरञ्जनोऽसि
Good evening, everyone. I'll begin with a short story. This is the story of a man who had that divine energy within him. It was way back in 1930s. An elderly man was traveling in third class compartment in India. And the train was chock-a-block with people. And he was sleeping. And as he was sleeping on his berth, it was a night time, and his foot touched, or rather hit, a person who was sitting there. There were two people sitting there. Both were farmers. And the moment one person was hit, he shouted back to this elderly man, "How dare you? Don't you know how to sleep?" That was first. After some time, that man got up and said, "Oh, I'm sorry." He slept again. After some time, again he fell off to sleep. And his foot touched another farmer. And that farmer shouted back again. He said, "Okay, I'm sorry again." And next time he never slept. He sat there. Whole night he was sleeping, was sitting there. Now, this was one event. Same man. Many, many years back, was in South Africa, 7th June 1893. It was a journey from Durban to Pretoria. And there was a man sitting in the first class compartment. And a European complained that how dare this man is sitting here. And he informed the authorities, and authorities came and told that man to go in the third class compartment. He refused. And this man was thrown out at St. Petersburg railway station. And after that, he was not the same person. It was an insult. and he revolted back, and there was a revolution in South Africa. So this was in 1893. And after that, so many years passed. And here, the same man, now traveling in Indian Railways, in third class boogie, and saying sorry to those two farmers who did not know who this old man was. And when the station came, this old man here in 30s, he came out of that train and everybody started shouting Mahatma Gandhi ki jai. And that time they understood who is this man. They never knew. And they felt ashamed. What we said to this? Why I'm telling you this story? The same man, once upon a time, so many years back, he could not stand that insult. He could not tolerate what those people did to him. And there was a revolution. There was a revolt. But the same man, now over the period of time, has undergone some cataclysmic changes, some spiritual metamorphosis. And he's a different man. He has become so humble. What was this? This in fact was the miracle of life. From where he had started and where he reached. So that was the story of M.K. Gandhi. The two events of his life. And this tells us many, many things. How do we progress in life? There's one more event I remember. Mahatma Gandhi was giving a speech in one assembly. A huge meeting was there. And there was one Pathan sitting in that meeting. His name was Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan. He's known as Frontier Gandhi. So he was sitting in that meeting. And one of the gentlemen from the crowd got up. And he said and shouted, "You coward." And he started abusing Gandhiji. Like anything, right, left and center. You are coward, you don't do anything, you are a hypocrite and so many things. And the insult was public insult in front of the whole audience. And Mahatma Gandhi was just sitting like that. Without saying a single word, just calm, silent. So this man who was sitting there, Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan, he saw everything. He noticed everything. He saw how this man is insulted and what is his reaction. The maturity with he reacted, with which he reacted. The sweetness of nature and that non-aggressive behavior. And that influenced him so much that later on he joined Gandhiji. And so much so that he became almost the right hand and he was known as Frontier Gandhi. He established a new movement that was known as Khudai Khidmatkar, Friends of God, later on. So what is this? As I was thinking of these two events today, I was thinking, what is it that makes the man to change his behavior? What is it that leads to internal transformation? So this journey is very, very delicate. This journey is very much internal. And each one of us has to take that journey. Somebody has beautifully said, we don't move from darkness to light. We move from lesser light to higher light. Lesser understanding to higher understanding of life. That's what life is all about. So creating miracles in life. How to create this miracle? In America, long back, there was a magician, you must have heard his name, Harry Houdini. He was stuntman, illusionist. You tie him in any way, he will come out of it. You put him, you tie his hands, handcuffs, and then his legs, his feet, his whole body, and then you put him in a box and lock it, and that box into another lock. Another box, lock it, and within few seconds he will come out. He was Harry Houdini, very famous stuntman. Once it happened in Spain, the whole public is sitting, and sometimes you know what they used to do? They used to lock him in one box and the box would be thrown into ocean and he would still come out. With multiple locks and multiple chains and everything he will come out. So he became worldwide famous for this stunts. He was Harry Houdini, the magician. once it happened in Spain, the whole public had gathered and he was into the lock. And they were waiting for him 3 hours. He did not come out. It never happened before. And when he came out, after 3 hours of strenuous methods, his attempts, people asked him, what happened? He said, people fooled me this time. I was searching locks, but the truth was, it was unlocked. It was not locked only. They fooled me this time. In the similar manner, the treasure of life, there are no locks to it. But we feel there are locks and we keep on searching keys and we keep on searching methods. But in fact, drop all these locks, drop all these rationalizations, drop all this everything and become what we are. In fact, we are what we are when we are situated in our own original self. The moment we go out of it, we become disturbed and we search happiness. It's just like there is one room and there is a darkness and we want to drive out that darkness from that room. And we are using swords and we are using enemy, army to remove that darkness. How to remove that darkness? The only method of removing darkness is to light a lamp. The moment the lamp is lit, the darkness is dispelled. This is what life is all about. So in today's session, we will see certain tricks, certain methods. And these are not just words. And I would request you not to cast just words. But there are pauses in between. In those pauses, go within. Go inside. Search your life. Scan your own life and find out how I can apply these principles. Many people have talked about life and many people have talked about creating miracles in life. I would love to summarize the teachings of history, the humanity, in few tricks. In fact, this is a very, very simple journey. But in fact, as I said, we have made it complicated. There are about 26 things we are going to discuss today. And we have less time. So in short, it will be discussion plus experience. I don't just want to deliver a talk, but it should be a deep experience. So as you hear, at the same time, keep on doing self-checking, self-analysis, soul-searching, introspection, retrospection. This is my life. Here I stand. As we saw in the meditation, there was a screen. And on that screen, I saw everything as a detached observer. We are so much attached to life that we are not able to see it. Slightly move away in between sometime so that you can see everything as Sakshi. That's known as detached observership. So the first principle, the first trick of creating miracles in life is acceptance. Acceptance. What I have to accept? First of all, I have to accept myself. I have to accept this body. In our clinical practice, so many times I see people come and they say, I don't like my nose, I don't like my ear, my eyes are like this, this. They have not accepted their body only. They are unhappy with their physical appearance. Have I accepted my body, first of all? Let me accept. Acceptance carries positive energy. Resistance carries negative energy. Accept yourself. Accept your weaknesses. Accept your imperfections. Accept the people with whom you are living. Probably the husband has not accepted the wife till now. Probably the wife has not accepted the husband till now. Or probably the parents have not accepted the children. Because whatever they tell to the children, they don't do it. They are reluctant. There is a huge generation gap. I am reminded of a very beautiful saying by Khalil Gibran. He says to parents, your children are not your children. They are from you, but not for you. So don't thrust your desires unfulfilled wishes upon them. You wanted to become something you couldn't. So you want now your child, your children to fulfill that desire. Acceptance of one's physical appearance. Acceptance of people who are around you. Accepting situations where we are placed. There was a Shah, a big person, who used to travel in his palanquin every day. And he would see in that town a dervish. Dervish is a Muslim fakir or something like that, a religious person, sitting at one corner of the road and smiling blissfully. First day he saw. The second day, the Shah was going by the same way. He saw the same person again sitting there. Third day he wanted to see the same person and he went by the same path. In his palanquin. So, after seeing him many days like that, he went to that person and asked, "How is that you are so happy all the time? Because I am observing you from so many days, you are always happy. You are smiling blissfully. Do you have a lot of wealth?" He says, "I don't have anything even to eat." First. Then he says, "You must be enjoying good health." The fakir says, "Whole night my body was aching in pain because of cold." Then he says, "You must be having very good family." He says, "I am alone. I move as wind." "Then what is your recipe or happiness? How is that you are so happy all the time when you don't have anything?" The dervish says, "The place where I am is the place of my spiritualization." Very beautiful statement. The place where I live is the place of my spiritualization. I have accepted this situation. I have accepted what is coming in front of me. And not just accepted, I express a sense of gratitude for what I have in life. Rather than becoming a complaint box, I accept everything that life is presenting to me. And that's what makes me happy. So the first principle, the first trick of happiness, of creating miracles in life, is acceptance. Accept that every soul is different. Accept that every soul is unique. Accept that everyone is having his own specialities. You cannot thrust your desires upon others. You cannot say that my child should become this, my child should become that. He has his own independence. Yes, you can guide them. You can nurture them. You can sustain them. But remember that that's a seed and it will grow on its own. Accept the people. Accept the situations. Accept the circumstances. Acceptance doesn't mean defeat. This is a mistake people do. Accept means I have accepted defeat. Now I will not do anything. Acceptance means accept it and now start the new journey. Some very adverse situation has come. A very difficult situation has come. You know, Thomas Alva Edison in 1910, his everything, whole plant, investigation, that firm which he had erected, everything got burnt. Everything was destroyed. He was just standing like that, watching everything. Everything was getting burnt. Evening 5 o'clock, 1910, New Jersey, and Thousand Island. Everything was, whatever investigation, whatever researches he had done, everything was getting burnt. His son came running and asked, "Father, what is happening?" He said, "Nothing, call your mother. This spectacle is so beautiful. You will never see such a picture." And he said, "Call your mother so that she can see." And he said, "Very beautiful thing. All our mistakes which we have done are getting burnt up. Look at this." If any other person would have been there, he would have straight away landed up in depression. "Oh, everything which I have done, everything is getting burnt." And within 6 months, he erected everything again. That's the spirit. That's the acceptance means, doesn't mean that you just sit on time. You just sit and don't do anything. This experience his son shared in Reader Digest of 1952. "This was my father." So the first trick of creating miracles in life is a deep sense of acceptance. Acceptance doesn't mean that you stop learning. Acceptance doesn't mean that you stop changing. Accept it and now work on it. How to come out of that situation? How to go about that situation. So the first principle is acceptance. The second principle of creating miracle in life is balance. You know, human mind is like pendulum. It goes to that side, it goes to this side. When it goes too much towards left, in fact it is not going to the left, it is gathering momentum to come to the right. When it goes to the right, it's not going towards right, it is gathering momentum to come back to the left. So it keeps on moving. We move from extremes. Sometimes we develop too much attachment to life and sometimes too much detachment. Sometimes too much virtuous and sometimes viceless. Full of vices, vicious. So this keeps on happening and happening. Can we do something so that we strike a balance in our sleep, in our food, in our habits, in our exercises? Sometimes too much exercise and sometimes no exercise. Sometimes gaining weight, sometimes becoming so thin, anorexia nervosa, and dying out of it. So, the principle of life is the principle of balance. To strike that fine balance, what time I get up in the morning, sometimes very early, sometimes very late. Can I fix some time? How much I eat? Sometimes too much, sometimes very less. Can I strike a balance? You know, they clap for those who walk on the rope. In Hindi, it is known as rassi. Not for those who walk on the road, rasta. The clapping is for those who walk on the rope. Because there is a balance. So the principle of creating miracle in life, the second principle is strike a very, very subtle balance. Sometimes becoming workaholic, working day and night, and sometimes not doing anything, becoming a couch potato lying on the bed all the time. Sometimes here, sometimes there. Sometimes here, sometimes there. This is the principle of life, that we come to the state of balance. Learn where I have gone to the extremes. Ati sarvatra varjate. Give up the extremes. Come to the middle path. That's shown in the life of Lord Buddha. For 6 years, he practiced penance. So much so that his body shriveled up. His body was about to die. And he understood, once upon a time, I was drowned in indulgence. Before going and leaving his family, he was drowned in indulgence. Indulgent life. And later on, he went to extreme. Too much penance. And he understood both paths were wrong. Self-indulgence and self-abnegence. Self-negligence. Both paths were wrong. And he understood, this is not what is. If this tapasya, this penance, this ascetic life is making me so weak and infirm, probably this is not the whole truth. And he sat in that Bodhi tree and he resolved, unless and until I know the truth, I will not get up. And that very night, he got enlightened. And that very light, he understood some deep principle of life. So, give up extremes. Strike a balance. Food, sleep, exercise, relationships. Just take the example of relationships. Sometimes I am too much attached to some person. Calling, messaging, and sometimes totally detached. No contacts. Can we have a relationship which is loving at the same time detached? Too much familiarity breeds contempt, hatred. When we start knowing a person too much and we go near to him too much, we start seeing his faults. That's why they say that if you admire some person, don't go very near to him. Let there be some distance. If you admire somebody, if you like somebody's speech, keep away from him. So that you keep on learning from that person. Otherwise, if you go near to him, you will see, oh, you also do the same thing. You also have the same habits. Oh, we also have the same. So what is the use? So that respect, that dignity, that goes away. So strike a balance in relationship means, for example, that's known as psychological distancing. Husband and wife relationship. There should be a distance. When I say distance, that is known as psychological distancing. There would be a respect maintained between them, a love maintained between them. The moment they come very near to each other, too much contact, And gradually, there would be dislike after some time. That's what is seen. And that's known as psychological distancing. So, whether it is any relationship, always have a, give space to that other person. Everybody needs a space to think, to breathe. Do not interfere in anybody's personal life. Whosoever that person may be, because every person is a different individual and he needs privacy. We forget that many times. So the second principle of creating miracles is balance. The third principle of creating miracle is creativity. The same life, the same dull and drab life, morning get up, do this, go to office, come back. There is no change, there is no creativity in that. Everything that you do, that should be something different. You know, recently, as I was coming at one station, there was one person who was selling that limca, soft drinks. So how he was doing it? First he threw it like that 2-3 times. Then he took a glass and he poured it like this from above and then did like this. So he was so happy and so joyous, so jubilant. He was enjoying his work. He was enjoying his task and there was a creativity in whatever he was doing. So whatever we do, bring some creativity, some newness. Unless and until there is a creativity, life becomes very, 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 very commonplace. Something new should be there in life. Get up in the morning and have some new thoughts. Get up in the morning and decide what I have to do. What is the new thing I can do, which I have never done till now? You know, in our hospital, many times we see people come and what they do, they give one flower to each patient and go away without saying a single word. That gives a small act of goodness that gives them happiness. It's something new that they are doing because they enjoy it. And just as a child is so creative, child has so many questions. We have lost all those questions. We have lost the creativity. Bring something new in thoughts, in feelings, in emotions. That's why most important thing in life is keep on reading new things every day. Keep on listening new things every day. Keep on gaining new knowledge from everything. Become like a child who is inquisitive, who has the questions. Oh, from where the sun is coming? You know, there was an English author, D.H. Lawrence. He writes, once a child asked him, "Uncle, why the leaves are green?" Now he could have brushed aside these questions. Green means green, finish. Don't ask. So he thought, what answer should I give? Should I tell him that it is because of chlorophyll? But then why the chlorophyll is green? The question still remains. So he said, "Child, I don't know. Once I know, I will let you know." This is how he answered that child. "I will let you know once I know it." So that desire to know should be there. Desire to do something new. What new I can do? You are listening something, listen with a different way. You are writing something, write something different which you have never written. You are talking, bring some newness in that speech, in that talk. In your emotions, in your feelings, in your planning of life. You are traveling every day. What new I can do today during travel? What new I can do in my office? What new I can do with my family? What new I can do with my children? Everything, some newness should be there. Because if you keep on doing the same thing for a long period of time, you become tired, fatigued, exhausted. So the third principle is creativity. The fourth principle is digital detox. Have you heard of detox? There are detox centers where you are given fruit juices and so many things to things. And so what we need now is digital detox. You know, in Mount Abu, we have huge retreats keep on happening there. So recently there was a medical conference, 3 days medical conference, mind, body, medicine. In that conference, one lady came, one doctor, probably head of the department of some college. And while coming, her mobile got lost. So the moment she reached Mount Abu, she did not have any mobile. And 3 days she attended the retreat, the conference. And at the end, she narrated her experience was so beautiful. He said, "Thank God that my mobile got lost. I could enjoy so much peace here. No phone calls, nothing. Definitely phone is very useful. Definitely we need media. But that should not replace peace of our mind. We need it. But there should be some moments of digital detox. Just sit alone in calm and talk with yourself. What is the screen time? Nowadays they talk in terms of screen time. What is my screen time? How much time I look at the screen? In India, there is one institution named Hans, neurological institution. Recently, one lady got admitted there for texting addiction. Texting. This is a new addiction. She used to text almost 6 to 8 hours a day. Now she is undergoing treatment. Texting. Her hands, you know, they just don't stop. They want to text something. They want to answer everything. If somebody sends one line, at least 10 lines you send. This is known as texting addiction. So even texting has become an addiction. So we need a period of silence. Disconnect to reconnect. Disconnect to reconnect. That's what is needed. So digital detox. And then next thing is exercise. Next principle of creating miracle in life is exercise. Simple exercise. You know what happens during exercise? Some endorphins, happiness hormones are released from the brain. You are feeling depressed, do some exercise. You are not the same person after doing exercise. And if you see in our life, how much time we are giving for exercise? Hardly anything. Hardly anything. Take out some time. And exercise means simple exercise, simply walking. You know, one American author has written a beautiful thing. He said, I had a fight with my father once. Whole night I was fighting with my father. And by the time it was morning, early morning, my father said, either you will stay here or I. And I was also very angry. I said, I don't want to stay with you. And he left the home. And he started walking. And later on he realized he did not have money also. Because in anger he left house. So he started walking. It was a morning hour, 4 o'clock. He started walking. 1 kilometer, 2 kilometer, 10 kilometers. And during walking he realized it was my mistake. I should go and say sorry to my father. And this he describes in Benefits of Walking. Mind got fresh during walking. Mind understood something new principle. Just early morning wake up and start walking. And some new things will come back to your mind. Some new realization. A problem which you are trying to solve the whole night. Like Archimedes, you will suddenly say, Eureka, Eureka, Eureka. And run out of that bathing tub. Because if you think of some problem, it doesn't get solved. Leave it. And then suddenly solution comes. You run after the butterfly. It runs away. You stand and the butterfly sits. It's something like that. So, exercise. Simple exercise is walking. How many of you love walking in the morning? Early morning walkers? Very less. Go for walking and see the miracle. Go early morning for walking and see the beauty of nature. The birds, the chirping of birds, the sky, the ocean, the waves, the sea, the rocks, everything which is in the nature. It refreshes the mind. And that's what the miracle, this is how the miracle is created in life. And then next is forget and forgive. Forget and forgive. This is a very important thing. We all are carrying something against somebody. Somebody has insulted me. Somebody mistrusts me. Somebody deceived me. Somebody alleged against me. He leveled false allegation against me. I am carrying so many negativity about so many people in my life. Unless and until I forgive them. Why I want to forgive them? Not for themselves, but for my own sake. Unless and until I forgive, I am not going to get peaceful. This is a very, very subtle and very important principle of life. No matter what they have done, it was my some old account with them that got cleared. But now, let me forgive them. You know, there was a lady who was sensually assaulted by a man. And later on, this lady became a surgeon, a doctor. And one night, an emergency patient came. There was a stab injury. And she saw it was the same man. Now it was a dilemma in front of her whether to operate him, save him. And in that area, that was the only hospital. So she didn't understand. She went to the church. She stood in front of the statue. And suddenly a vision came in front of her eyes. Instead of Jesus Christ, she is there. And she is saying, "Forgive them, for they know not what they have done." And she got the realization, this man, whatever he had done, I have to save him. After that vision, she came out and she operated on him. And he got saved and returned on. He was so much in repentance. So we have to forgive people. Now, all of you, again sit alert for 2 minutes. Close the eyes. I see in front of myself all those people. Who were rude to me, who spoke against me, who criticized me, many times insulted me. I see all those people. Who did not help me when I needed them the most. What feelings I have for these people. Just as God is merciful, Al-Rahman, Al-Rahim, ocean of mercy, ocean of compassion, can I forgive them? Let me forgive all of them. Because they were under influence of some vice of anger. And for my own peace, I want to forgive them today. No matter what they have done. Unconditionally, I forgive them. And this practice I have to do for next 3 months, every day. Immersing them in front of my eyes. Just as God has forgiven me for my unrighteousness, I want to forgive them for their unrighteousness. And in one way, are they not my greatest friends? They taught me to remain stable in the face of difficult situations. So wholeheartedly today, in this gathering, I forgive them all. And lo and behold, my mind is becoming peaceful. I am a peaceful soul. Completely pure. Radiating pure vibes. full of good wishes and pure feelings for everyone. I am floating in the ocean of bliss. Gradually open the eyes. So, every day, make this practice. Emerge in front of your mind's eyes, those people, and unconditionally forgive them. Not for their sake, but for my own sake. For my own peace, for my own happiness. Because so long I carry the attitude of subtle revenge, they can never become my friend. Then next is gratitude. Thankfulness. You know, some people maintain gratitude journal. At night, thank everyone. Thank wife, children, parents, friends, boss, everyone. Before sleeping, maintain that gratitude journal. There was a person who had a severe headache and he tied a band here. And one sage came, he said, what happened? He said, I am having headache. That's why this band, so much headache. He said, what is your age? He said, 30 years. He asked, did you have any such headache before? He said, never. This was first time, the worst headache of my life. The sage asked, did you tie the band of thankfulness ever before? Today you had a pain, you had pain, so you tied that band and showing that you are unhappy. But when you were not unhappy and you were healthy and no headache, did that time ever you tied the band and showed to God, oh God, thank you. So tie this band of thankfulness. Thank everyone. Thank God, thank nature, thank people, thank neighbor. Thank even those who criticized because they made me so powerful. I was so sensitive baby, feeling devi. Touch me not. Somebody said something, unhappy. Somebody said something, gone. Somebody said something, 3 days, I will not talk with him. Now nature has become strong. So I am thankful even to all those who abused, who criticized, who insulted, who alleged, who leveled false allegations, cast aspersions on me. Everything, I am thankful to everyone. So this gratitude has got positive energy. And then next principle is habits, new habits. What are the best new habits you would like to have in yourself? Can I have some feedback from you? What are the habits which you think you should have but you don't have? Anyone? Any new habit which you want, that should be there in you? Yes? What are the good habits? Yeah? Reading books. Okay, that's a very good habit. Books are our greatest friends. But now we are so busy, we have no time to even open the book. Once upon a time, we used to read long back. So this is a good habit. Create that new habit. So new healthy habits are needed. Getting up early in the morning. Meditation. Reading something. Being in silence. Being in solitude. Self-talk. These are the good habits. Spiritual habits which you have to develop. And then next is journey. Which journey? Internal journey. We do outside journey. What about internal journey? There is a world within me. There is a macrocosm and there is a microcosm and macrocosm. But this inside world is so vast. There are so many areas, dark areas of my mind, I don't know what is there. Some nooks and corners, some hatred is hidden. In some corner, some lust is hidden. In some corner, some grudge is hidden. And I don't know. The internal world is very big. Have I explored it? Have I made that odyssey, that journey within? If not, let me take out time. You know, I will tell you about my own life. When I was 16 years old, 16 or 17, my father wanted me to become a doctor, and he got some books. In India, there is one place called Sevagram. And in that Sevagram, there is a medical college, and it is an autonomous medical college. They have got four subjects: physics, chemistry, biology, and the fourth subject is Gandhian thoughts. You have to study the life of Gandhiji in order to clear that entrance. So I started studying that book, and the name of the book was The Story of My Experiment with Truth, autobiography. And I was reading that book first day, second day, third day, and whatever the author said in that book, I felt that is applying to my life. And reading that book, I went in silence for next 6 months. 6 months I did not talk with anybody. My father was worried, what has happened, let us take to doctor. But that was the period I underwent sudden transformation. I was going towards materialistic life. Suddenly, I turned towards spiritual life. I realized the goal of this life is God realization and self-realization, not this worldly things. And suddenly I turned. The direction was changed. For 6 months, no talk with anybody. Such deep silence. As if, what is in front of me? What I have to do in life? At that young age, I took the decision, no, my life is not for myself. My life is for the world service. My life is to make this world wiseless. My life is for the benefit of this world. These were very elevated thoughts for a young boy. But these were the seeds which were sown during that period of silence, where I pondered upon the mysteries of life. What is this? What is that? What I have to do? What I have to go? And then I got admission in MBBS. Throughout the MBBS, on one side was medical studies, on the other side was spiritual studies. Struggle. Sometimes this would pull, sometimes that will pull. Finished MBBS. Again, the same silence, second time. Internship. Third silence after that. And all this silence made me to ponder, I have to do something else. And that search ultimately took me to Mount Abu, where I found a spiritual community where similar-minded people are there who are doing self-searching. And they have realized something more. After having studied all the religions of the world, after having gone through almost all the institutions of the world, after having practiced, not just along with medical studies, practicing all the different principles of spirituality, ultimately I came to the conclusion, no, something else is needed. I was so restless and passionate to realize the ultimate truth of life. And ultimately that landed me in Mount Abu. And where I felt for the first time calm, I became calm. After an intense search, study of all the religions and what is the crux of that religion. So, journey. The next is K, is keeping oneself busy. This is a very beautiful thing. Keep yourself busy in something, because an empty mind is devil's workshop. Keep yourself busy in something or other, something or other. Keep on doing something. Gardening. Go in the garden and learn gardening. Read some books. Go around walking. Learn some classes. Take some distance education courses. Learn language. Keep on learning something else. Learning is the best thing in life. So learning new things. So keeping oneself busy. And then L. L means love yourself. In English, there is something, they say fly, F-L-Y. First, love yourself. We are taught to love others, but what about myself? Do I love myself? I hate myself somewhere. I have so much self-victimization. I play the victim card many times. I self-victimize myself so many times. So love yourself. Next is M, motivate yourself. If you fall down, don't wait that somebody else will come and motivate me and tell me and teach me something. I have to rise up. Every time I fall. In English, there is a saying, our greatest glory lies not in never falling, but in rising every time you fall. It's not that somebody who has never fallen is a great person. If you study the life of Abraham Lincoln, there's a list of failures in his life. Did this? Failed. Did this? Joined Congress? Failed. His fiancée died. His mother died. This. A list of failures. At last, in 1864, elected as 16th President of America. After a series of so many defeats. That is how Abraham Lincoln is. And he became the greatest President of America. How? He did not yield. He did not accept defeat, even though so many things happened. So the principle of creating miracle in life is motivate yourself. And for that, as I said, reading good talks and being in good company is very important. And then next is nature. How many of you love nature? Everybody almost. But how many times we seek nature? As I said earlier also, go all alone and sit near ocean and see the waves which are coming. Feel the oneness with nature, the chirping of birds, everything. There was one German philosopher, mystic, Eckhart. Mr. Eckhart. Once he was sitting in one forest, all lost in himself. Two of his friends were walking by. And they said, oh, he's alone, let us go to him. And they came to him. And he said, we came to give you company. He said, I was enjoying the company, the greatest company. You came and destroyed my company. I was already enjoying good company. It's because of your coming, my company is broken. So go in nature. Love nature. Appreciate nature. Feel nature. Feel the energy, feel the atmosphere early morning, away from the world, where there is not even the sound of footstep of human being. Such silence, such deeper silence, and the greatest discoveries are done only in silence. Know that. The problems of the lives would get solved in silence. So seek nature. And then next, related to that, observe silence and solitude. One is nature, another is learn to be silent. As I said, in my own life, I have gone almost 3 to 4 periods of silence. The first was for 6 months. The second was for few days. The third was for 3-4 months. And these were the only periods. I think today I am standing and sitting here. It's because of those silence. That energy is still sustaining me. Because that was a very, very powerful silence. Where I was totally disconnected from the world. And went so within myself. What is who I am? What I am? What I have to do? What is the goal of life? Why I am here? Such questions, they assailed me like anything. And out of that storm I came out. So it was that silence. And then positive thinking. P means positive thinking. We are going from A to Z. P is positive thinking. In the worst of the scenario, think positive. Like there was a man who had a habit of saying, even worse could have happened. So once his friend came to him and he said, today I dreamt that I died. I was going, I met with an accident and I died. So this man came, even worse could have happened. He said, now what is the worst than this? He said, actually dying is the worst. You have not died. So in the worst of the situation, in the negative of the most negative situation, seek, there is some hidden positive there. Something is there. Some signal is there. So positivity has very great power in it. And then Q. Q means quit a bad habit. Addictions. We are all addicted people. You know. Somebody is addicted to sweet. Somebody is addicted to chocolates. Somebody is addicted to TV. Somebody is addicted to net. A patient was brought in the hospital. Unconscious. And doctor asked, what happened? Relative said, nothing. He is a Facebook addict. 4 days, net is off. so got unconscious. That was the addiction. It's how we are addicted to so many things. Can we de-addict ourselves? Quit a bad habit. First find out which is that habit which is damaging my everything. Is it getting up late? Sleeping late? Is it watching television? It's spending too much time online? Or the greatest danger, YouTube. YouTube has become a black hole. It sucks. You start from where and you end where? The youths of this world, they are turning vicious. Body and body consciousness. No discussion of something spiritual. They are pulled, attracted to all the nonsensical things people are showing. And that's a business of flesh business which is going on in the world. And that have driven them mad. You go to any jail of the world, half of the people who are there, they will narrate you their story that we did this sexual crime. Why? Because that 10 minutes of passion. And that was preceded by watching videos. And that resulted in this. Now we repent, the whole life in jail. A temporary titillating joy. And that which is not, that is a pseudo thing, a wrong thing, an immoral thing. Video games. You know, there was a study on terrorists. They were asked, what was the game you used to like in childhood? They said video games. One car here, one car here. Fighting, fighting, fighting. This is what they loved in childhood, and then they turned into terrorists later on. These are the addictions which we are having. And then next, this is one. Time is getting up. I will take 5 more minutes. The next is Rajyoga meditation. Meditation is one of the beautiful method of creating miracles in life. Just sit in meditation, calm your mind for some time, and you understand, some new understanding will come. You have heard of Emily Curie? She was the first lady who received 2 Nobel Prize. Emily Curie. Whole night, one day, she was trying to solve one problem, she couldn't. So she fell off to sleep, thinking of that problem, some mathematical sum. And when she got up in the morning, she saw that sum has been solved. And she saw whose handwriting it is. It was her own handwriting. She got up at night and solved it. So it was the unconscious, the subconscious mind which had done that trick. You try to solve something with your conscious mind, it doesn't get solved. Calm the conscious mind. There is an area of subconscious mind, the iceberg. In that, all solution is there. Every solution of every problem is within us. We don't have to ask anybody. Everything is within us. So, meditation. It calms the mind. And a calm mind is the most powerful weapon in the world. It's not that 10 people are sitting in the meeting and trying to solve some problem. Calm the mind. Empty it with all the unnecessary and waste thoughts, and it becomes calm and powerful. And then next is also related earlier, which I said, as stress management. Find out the list of stressors in life. And next is T, time management. Find out the list of time wasters. Everybody should sit and find out, what are my time wasters? Phone calls, texting, videos, or traveling, unnecessary traveling, or chit-chatting. What are my time wasters? Or some unnecessary relationship which is not needed and yet I am maintaining it, which is illegal, immoral, and yet it's going on for a long time. What is the time wasters? What are the time wasters of my life? What are the time wasters and what are the energy drainers of my life? So these are the 2 things. Stress management and time management. You know, there was one lady who was going to give lecture on time management. Okay, she was a speaker. So she was in train, and the train stopped at one place. And she got down and started, got busy in purchasing something, and the train left. And this was the speaker for time management. She was going to teach others what is how to do time management. So time management is one such thing. Even the speakers who talk on time management, probably even they are, it's a lifelong subject. You have to keep on learning time management each and every day. Theoretical knowledge is not enough. You have to keep on learning about it. So time management, stress management. And then you means understanding yourself and self. Try to understand what are my emotions. Who I am, what I am. I don't know myself. I am trying to understand others. I am not understanding myself. Mark Twain has written, once he sat in one church and there was a lecture going on donation, on giving money. And he was so impressed by that lecture. He said, this time I am going to donate whatever money I have. And then that bowl was started moving from like that in the church, you know. They go like that with that container. And that vessel moves. If anybody wants to give anything, give. So he was sitting. And during the lecture he thought, I will give everything. Once the lecture finished, he said, what is the need of giving everything? I will give $100. Okay. And then that person started moving like that. And he saw everybody is giving just $50. Why should I give $100? And then after some time, when his row came, and he saw $50 is too much. I'll give $10. And when that vessel came in front of him, what he did, you know? He saw here and there and took few money from dollars from that and kept in his pocket. This is how the mind is. What he was thinking earlier and what happened. And later on he was thinking, why I did this? Who I am? What I am? I am so confused. I am wearing so many masks. So understanding self. And then next is visualization. Visualize. This is a very powerful tool. Seeing with mind's eye is equivalent to having experienced it with own direct eyes. So visualization is a very powerful tool. You can study about it. Time is less. And then next is wakefulness. W is wakefulness or waking up early in the morning. Two things are there. How many of you get up at 6 o'clock? 7 o'clock? 4 o'clock? Oh. 5 o'clock? Some of them. The earlier you get up, more time you have. The earlier you get up, morning hours are so fresh, so calm. People are sleeping and you get up and so fresh energy. And you try to disconnect yourself from this body and try to meditate and go above the body and enter into that world of spirits. And new secrets will come to you. So morning meditation is very, very powerful meditation. Everyone make it a habit to, this is a new habit you have to create. It takes 21 days. Keep on doing one thing for 21 days, it becomes habit. So form this habit. Make a list of new habits. Getting up early in the morning, or somebody is keep on drinking tea all the time or coffee all the time. That's also a sort of addiction. Anything which is done in excess is addiction. And then next is X. X means X-ray. X-ray means self-checking. Morning, evening. Before sleeping, do some self-checking. Maintain a diary. Was I okay? Was my speech okay? Did I hurt somebody? Was I compassionate? Was I punctual? Some self-checking, short, that is known as X-ray of your own self. And then, why? 25th, why? Why means yoga nidra. How many of you have heard this word? Yoga nidra. Nowadays, lot of scientific researches are being done on yoga nidra. Yoga nidra means yogic sleep. Yoga nidra means those who suffer from insomnia, they are advised this. There are many steps, I will not go in detail of that. You can go and read about it. What is yoga nidra? Yoga nidra means when you sleep, how do you sleep? First relax the body, concentrate on breathing, then take some powerful thoughts, rotate attention of consciousness and relax totally. Mahatma Gandhi had said once, when I sleep at night, I die. The next day when I get up, I am reborn. Because the today's stresses, today's whatever that has happened is today's. Why should I carry it tomorrow? So before sleep, the method of sleeping should be so, it is also, yoga nidra is known as power nap. You sleep for 15 minutes, you get up and you feel energy as if you have slept for 4 hours. So read more about yoga nidra. You will get on internet a lot of information about it and the methods and the 8 steps of yoga nidra. How you go to sleep at night. Because whatever thoughts I had at night before sleeping, the same thought I get up in the morning. The last thought becomes the first thought. And the last thing, Z, means zeal and enthusiasm. We should be bubbling with enthusiasm. That vivacity, that animation of life should be there. Don't do anything just as if you're dead. Do it with happiness, do it with joy, do it with love, do it with enthusiasm. So enthusiasm makes the difference. So being enthusiastic in life is to create miracle in life. So this is starting from A till Z. About 26 tricks. Yeah, tell me. I was missing inquisitiveness. Inquisitiveness means curiosity. You know, there is one book in English, Sense of Wonder, by Rachel Carson. In the morning also I mentioned about it. So that lady, 70-year-old, above I think, she decided what I have achieved in life, I have not achieved anything. I want to rediscover my life. So she made a friendship with 3-year-old boy. 3-year-old. And followed that boy for till the boy became 5 years. 2 years, she behaved in the similar manner as that boy. The boy was crawling, she also crawled. The boy was putting thumb in the mouth, she also putting thumb in the mouth. The boy was saying, oh, what is this, ocean? So she was saying, oh, ocean. The boy was crying, she also cried. The boy was smiling, she also smiled at the age of 75. Because she felt as if I have missed something in life. And later on she wrote this book, Sense of Wonder. And she wrote, I felt so much joy to become a child again. So I means inquisitiveness, curiosity. Just as child is curious to know, what is this, what is that, what is that, what is that. And we stifle their curiosity. It is nothing. Just forget it. Concentrate on books, on studies. That's how we do. So encourage that curiosity. So I means inquisitiveness, curiosity. That wonder, oh, what is life? Early morning when you get up, oh, this is a new day. It should be filled with happiness today. I want to create some miracle in life. So this is in short about creating miracles, creating wonders in life. And who can create that? I myself. Don't wait for any angel to come and do that for you. You yourself has to do it. Have to do it, this creation of miracle. Okay? Om Shanti. Thank you. So all of you, please sit alert once again. Mind calm. And the intellect has stopped wandering. Body completely still. I am a peaceful soul. Eyes closed. I am radiating divine energy. My whole body is filled with healing energy. I am a blissful soul, so calm, so quiet. The divine miracle has happened in my life. A ray of new hope. The laser beams of new understanding. The spark of luminosity a divine radiance. As if I'm enlightened. My whole being is filled with that supernatural power. I'm empowered. Atmosphere is filled with unearthly joy. The celestial, super sensuous sense of bliss, rapture. The stage of divine transport. Now gradually, wherever you are, just stand up. Open the eyes and stand up for a moment. Again close the eyes and hold each other's hand. Like this, each other's hand, close the eyes, hold each other's hand, whosoever is beside you. If nobody is there, still just stand like this. From my both hands, divine energy is radiating to this another person. And divine energy of these two people who are around me is coming to me. As if laser beams of this spiritual power is running through me. My whole body is receiving healing energy. The mind is becoming solidified, powerful. As if a circle of spiritual energy, the transference of divine energy, as if I have come back to my original being, so pure, so powerful. Deep silence. The energy of the entire universe is coming unto me. I am the center of this universe. I am the world benefactor. I am the master ocean of compassion. My life is to help the humanity. All are my brothers and all are my sisters. A sense of universal brotherhood within me. Now gradually sit down again. Om Shanti. Thank you. beautiful song going on, and with that song you can carry that divine energy and go from here.
Yeah.
The song says, I am at the top of the world.
Thank you very much for giving us such an experience. Thank you, Dr. Sachin, coming from all the way from India and giving us such a beautiful experience. And thank you, one and all. Good night.
Won't be surprised if it's a dream.